Welcome everybody to Little Buster's podcast, and today we will be discussing the Sasami root of Little Buster's EX. I'm your host Pepe, and I have finally surpassed my rival Aspi to become the new host of the Kazumatsuri podcast.
I am defeated, and now I am paralyzed.
Oh no, Aspi is here. I'll remember this, Aspi.
What are you meant to remember?
That's a good... I need to remember Sasami Root. Okay, today we have our regular cast, mostly Aspi and Naoki Saturn.
Oh!
Hello, guys. And we have returning to the podcast since the Haruka Root is Kanon. Hi, Kanon.
Rumameto ka. Yoroshiku!
Ah, yes. We also have another attendee here. His name is Roommate. Thank you for coming, Roommate.
Yoroshiku.
And for the first time, adeptArcanist will be joining us for the podcast today. How are you feeling, Adept?
Hi. I'm feeling okay. Looking forward to the podcast. All right.
Okay. To get things started, do you have your 30-second recap ready, Adept?
That I do. Half a year after the disastrous field trip, Ricky is drawn into another dream world where Sasasa turns into a black cat. Resolving to become a detective and help her out, Ricky draws on his friend's help as they're booted from the world one by one and finally realizes that the culprit is the cat Sasasari took care of as a child, who was lost and became a stray when her family moved. Although she tries to kick him out of the dream world, afraid that Kuro blames her and has bad intentions, Ricky finds his way back one way or another and helps her play with her pet one last time. Back in the real world, the two hold a funeral with the Natsumes and Komari, and Ricky muses on all the final wishes that go ungranted in this world.
Was that within 30 seconds?
I think I probably went a little long, sorry.
Better luck next time, Shonen.
We can put in a beep there. Alright. So, what does everybody think about the Sasagasami route?
I think you mean the meme root.
Oh yeah, this is absolutely.
I thought Sire was the meme root.
I mean,
yeah, this one has like actual content.
Yeah, I think Sire classifies more as the meme root because it has so much usable memes. This is the Little Buster's after root, the common root that we wish we had but never got.
Yeah.
Yeah.
After common, I like to think of it.
Thanks, Tonokawa.
And I think that kind of does jump into something, which is... at the start of this route, I really do love how we keep seeing, you know, how it does kind of work as a bit of an after common. We see that Ricky's been borrowing books from Mio all the time. He and Komari like to watch the stars. He has been changed by the events of the story. It's not just, you know... a thing that happened and then is never spoken of again.
Yeah, exactly. Right. It's like there's a real sense of continuity and like things carrying over from the illusionary world, which I think was a fear that a lot of people had after the end of Vanilla Little Buses, just like the world ended and none of it mattered. But here it's like clearly shown that like it did have effects on the real world. He doesn't remember everything, but he does remember a lot.
A lot of the relationships do carry over, not just from Ricky, but in between the characters, like I think more than any other route, this is the route where you see all the other characters, you know, interacting with each other. It's like the baseball practice, but in everyday life, you know.
Right.
Yeah, that's very true.
And of course, Ricky's still a stud.
Yeah.
I don't think he sniffs her. Hang on, give me a second.
Okay.
Consult the list. Better be.
What did you think of the route, Naoki?
Well, I think there's three parts to say about this route. Like, it's funny comedy-wise, it drags on a lot, and it has super, super heavy feels that you did not see coming.
Oh, wow. Well, we'll definitely get into that later. I think that's something that everyone can agree on.
Did not see coming.
Like, I think one of the first scenes in when you get into the route is Masato's sharing his muscle exerciser number two or number something. So you know from the very first line, oh god, this is gonna be crazy. Anyway.
Yeah, there's like you said, there's just so many great group interactions in this route.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And anyway. Funny yokes.
Funny yokes. What about you, Ken? What do you think of it?
I love it. It's hilarious. Mm. And then the feels hit you like a two-ton train.
Mm. I feel like this is definitely a route which showcases all of Ludbuster's strengths.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think, Aspie?
I mean, yeah, I love this route. It really caught me off guard because my first time reading it was with English edition after waiting all these years. A lot of people prepped me up by saying that it was the most disappointing route of EX. And I read it, and I felt the complete opposite. I think it's probably my favorite EX route. Like we've said, just all the amazing interactions, the characters, the great comedy. The feels aren't too heavy, but they hit their mark well.
Right.
Yeah, it's just a really, really good balance. And I also really appreciate the mystery aspect of this route. Riki plays detective like he never has before, and it's really cool.
Yeah, I really love that bit.
Mm.
This is the Ryukishi route of Little Busters.
Oh, come on. Don't drag
him
into this.
Yeah, come on, peeps. It's a good route.
Shut up.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. Yeah, like it's kind of like, you know, Riki is using his knowledge of what he remembers from the dream world and kind of using that to figure out what's going on here. And he makes, like, at first, when we see Sasami turn into a cat, like, I think it took a lot of us by surprise because it's like, wait a second, isn't this meant to be the real world? Like, the dream world's over. Why is there supernatural stuff happening? This is stupid. But the whole point there is that, as Riki shows us, like, we're not meant to take it as the real world. Like, that's a big hint that we're not in the real world anymore. So, yeah, it's lots of cool deductive reasoning by Riki in this route that I appreciate.
Apparently, somebody turning into a cat is just a hint that we're not in the real world.
Well, yeah, it's the same logic that people... Like, it's the same logic for Kud's route that we were saying back in that podcast, you know?
Yeah,
the
fact that you can teleport.
Now
silly.
We know about the dream world.
Yeah, the fact that you can mm-hmm. teleport a gear and throw it down and break her shackles, like, kind of implies that maybe this isn't literal.
Maybe.
Well, yeah, so
it's funny how he figures it out after. It's funny how he figures it out after, you know, realizing that, oh, your clothes don't transform. Your transformation doesn't follow logic.
That's actually, yeah, I remember he said that. You know, like, it doesn't follow the conventions of, like, real world logic. So, like, there's.
Yeah, like, it's following that sort of logic where it's something that makes sense rather than something that would actually happen, which is neat.
Yeah. Like, you can't explain it with some crazy scientific device. Yeah, it's interesting. I really like that sort of metafiction aspect to it.
The best EX route, I guess.
Why don't we talk about Sasami Route Funny Moments compilation?
Who's Sasami? All
right, okay.
Oh, Sasalami. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sarasala.
Sasamosa.
Sriracha.
All right, so... My favorite funny scene in the whole Sasami or Sasamosa Sasamosa in her route is the whole Mon Petit shenanigans. I make it the point that whenever I play a new route for the first time, I try to piss the main character off. Well, at least the target character off, and I was very successful in getting her to try out Mon Petit for like three times and even offering it to her. It comes to a point that you offer it to her when she's already human. It's like, what? Come on, Riki. Jesus.
Riki really can be a troll sometimes. Oh my god.
Yeah, it's like, you know, any sane person would figure out she'd be pissed off at that, but you still do it anyway.
Well, who said that stupid Riki only exists in Saya's route?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's why I like it so much. It's very reminiscent of Bakariki.
This route is also the premiere of, like, well, not really premiere, but kind of the first major role of Dorge. Like, he doesn't really appear elsewhere very often.
Dorge is my favorite crashing aeroplane.
Dorge is a wonderful seal.
He, like, he jumps off something, makes the goddamn sound of a crashing aeroplane. I should die.
Kanon, what's your favorite comedy scene?
I'm not Kanon, I'm Room. Roommate.
Oh, damn it. Oh, Roommate, what's your favorite comedy scene? The roommate scene?
the one where Masato goes on for like 5 minutes about how he's Kengo's new roommate. Roommate.
He just goes around and parades it to everyone.
Kengo's just like fucking taking it and just playing along like this fucking guy.
Speaking of Kengo, how weird is Kengo in this route?
Yeah, I talked about this a lot on the forum, but like, this is a unique Kengo we've never seen before. I like to call him Neo Kengo. It's a fusion of the crazy Kengo and the serious Kendo Kengo, both wrapped into one package. So like, he's like a lot more somber, but he's still wacky. Like, he's less loud, but he's still wacky.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
Yeah. I like to imagine that
the voice actor really sold it.
I like to imagine that this is kind of like just what Kengo settles down into when he doesn't have to hold up the act and he's not like overcompensating for having held up the act by playing up his muscle idiotness like 100%.
This is the real Kengo, boys.
Shin no Kengo.
Right, it's the kind of Kengo that loves stupid and fun things, but he will also deliberately stop you just to tell you a good night, just because that's what you do.
Aww. he's a bee. Anyway.
Cutest
Shin,
boy.
Raging Kengo Ball!
Not surprising that Salami falls for him.
I was so happy to hear that Riki is still regularly exchanging books with Mio. It's like this does a really good job of protecting the ships.
and surprisingly that Mio isn't even one of the routes that Tonokawa wrote.
Yeah, so
it's you can see how much Tonokawa loves Urobato.
There are lots of references to Mio's route in this route, actually. Like,
the
first thing that Mio notices when she sees Kat Sasami is like, her shadow seems weird. And then she just kind of mutters to herself, but no, that can't possibly happen again.
Right. She actually figured it out right at the beginning. She just didn't want to believe it. She should be the protagonist. This route would be so much shorter.
Well, that's because she's the she's a mystery buff. Like, she'd solve it instantly. Like,
yeah, of course. That is why she and Kurogaya just kind of get kicked out before they really get a chance to do anything. They're just too smart.
Yeah.
We don't even see Kurogaya.
Yeah.
Except
there was.
Well, we sort of see Kurogaya.
Yeah, there was one thing, wasn't there?
A very weird thing. I think we should reserve that when we talk about the dream world.
Right, yeah.
Anyway. Okay. Like, it's also interesting how we actually get into this route. Because, like, we start off in the dream world of Little Busters, and if you've played the vanilla Little Busters, you'd remember there was a scene with Sasami being playful with Kud's dogs, and that was a very hard CG to get, and apparently that's what kicks you into the route, right?
Yeah.
It does seem to be basically just like, keep from triggering flags with literally anybody else.
Mm-hmm. That too. It's like she's the bad enter? Or no. Anyway.
She's too difficult to get to be a bad end character.
But, well.
True bad end.
Pretty much, I guess this says that whatever you experience in the dream world carries over, even for characters that didn't play an actual major part in the dream world. Like, I think if you didn't get that scene, then you wouldn't be interested in Sasami's cat. And
why don't we talk about Sasami as a character for a bit?
Yeah. So Sasami as a character.
First impressions versus new impressions.
How about you get started, Rumumeto?
Sasami's a meme. Sasami's a friggin' joke in vanilla. Yeah, that's why I think this works so well as a meme route, because she was already a joke to begin with.
She's a stereotypical Ojo-sama tsundere, you know, rival.
Well, she is and she isn't.
Reoccurring mid-boss.
Because, yeah. Like, she actually, like, has a heart, like...
Yeah, I think that's what we do learn in this route, that...
You can see it in common route too. Like, I think even Kyosuke is like, this girl is harmless, but let's just, Rin needs a rival, so let's go along with it.
Yeah.
Right. The thing is, in the dream world, it wasn't the real Sasami, right? It was just some kind of NPC running around and behaving like Sasami.
Yeah.
So,
she says in her route that their field trip got cancelled, so she wasn't on the bus, we know.
Yeah, she wasn't. But I think the dream world is still, in a way, inspired by the real world. I wouldn't be surprised if Sasami had those random encounters with Rin in the hallway and, you know, tried to challenge her rival. So I think that's why those also happened in the dream world, although they were probably turned up to 11. You know?
Well, I do figure that they were memories.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've talked about this in the... earlier, I think it might have been the Common Root podcast, but Sasami is basically Rin's first friend. Like,
Pretty much in
the early story, like, she doesn't talk to anybody, but she can talk to Sasami just fine, because, like, for some reason, just fighting people is the only language she understands. So
it makes you wonder, like, is it because of Sasami's pride that she doesn't like to treat Rin as a friend, or is it because she actually realizes that that's, you know, the only way to get Rin to interact with her?
Yeah, I don't know. I think Sasami is very aware that, like, that's a friendship they have. And I think, like, there are some scenes in the common room I remember where Rin is just, like, completely ignorant of it.
Yeah. Like, Sasami is trying hard to build some kind of relationship with her, and Rin just, she doesn't care. She doesn't even remember.
Oh, God.
It's very interesting.
She is very attuned to other people. Like, I think her story about the whole softball club, about her protecting the rest of the members from bullying and eventually becoming the captain of the softball team, I guess shows how well she understands people. And yeah, who knows? Maybe that's exactly why she was challenging Rin to battles all the time.
Maybe that's why she's so popular. To get there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Hey, Kanon, do you want to talk about the fangirls?
What were their names again?
There's a Yukari, and I think there's a Rei.
It's
Kawagoe?
I don't remember the other one.
There are Rei Kawagoe, Sakiko Watanabe, and Yukari Nakamura.
Thank you.
Okay, got it.
Nice. The blue one is the best one. I don't remember what her name is.
One of them has Fuko's voice actor.
Right, they have Fuko...
The red one.
Wait a second. They have those three Clannad characters as their voice actors. It's Fuko, Ryo, and
they're all Clannad characters?
Yep.
What? They're all Clannad?
I didn't know
I'm
that
I'm pretty
one.
Sure okay. I made a post about this. I'm looking for it now.
Yeah, anyway.
I brought them up years ago. So it's probably in... Did I make a thread for that?
You did. You made a forum topic.
Nice. It's probably in there.
Yeah. Remember, you were just like, can we talk about best girls?
Sasami's junior.
Best girls who have
discussion.
Nothing to do with the route.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they only appear for a while, and you tried to convince them that Sasami is the cat. And then
it's a bit disappointing. We don't get more characterization for them here.
Yeah.
His little bust is EXEX.
Well, it's like there's that one scene, like, before we get into the route proper where we have the girls, isn't there? Isn't, like, Rin, like, trying to make amends with them?
Yes.
Yeah, that's where we learned their names.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're right. And they actually tell their names to Rin, and they don't, you know. I think they're a lot more pleasant when they're not trying to impress Sasami.
It was one of those very, very rare moments where Dean is acting like a grown-up.
Yeah, and I think the girls were, like, really taken aback by it.
Yeah.
Sasami-san, I do wonder when they're that.
I feel like we have lost on her as human beings. is what they said.
Yep. I do wonder whether that's a Dreamworld exclusive scene, since Rin, you know, it definitely relies on Rin having grown a lot through the course of the game.
It absolutely does. So, like, if that did happen, it would have had to happen after the bus crash.
Yeah, quite.
Well, I was going to disagree with you all
on one thing
back there. When you were talking about how you think Sasami is like trying to be a friend, I think they're both dumb and don't realize they're friends. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I think I'm with you, actually.
I think that makes more sense.
Well, maybe she's not trying to be a friend, but she is trying to construct some sort of relationship. And Rin doesn't let her because she doesn't care enough.
Yeah, fair.
Well, it works out in the end. You know, Rin tries to make friends.
Actually, should I talk? Is this a place to like segue into one more thought about the route proper?
Sure.
Because I think I'm actually kind of sad that Rin doesn't really do much in this route, because through common, she and Sasami, you know, they have their whole rivalry friendship thingamabob, and then ultimately Rin's actually one of the characters who does less in this route, I feel.
She does try. I mean, after all, you know, we're talking about cats here, and that is Rin's specialty.
True.
But she doesn't get along with black cats.
Yeah, apparently. How convenient.
I believe it's black cats don't get along with her.
Right, yeah, sorry. Kamari was pretty great in this route.
Yep.
Total MVP.
She was, I mean, I don't know where I found that out before, but I think it's never really discussed that Komari is Sasami's roommate.
It's said in this route, I think.
Yeah, in this route. Yeah, but I think before in Vanilla LB, all we know is that she's secretly friends with Sasami, and that Sasami asked her not to tell anyone.
Yeah, and that she already has a roommate because you can't get her as good roommate.
Right.
Yeah, but she is. I mean, Komari can get into the heart of anyone, so not surprising that she can get. Yeah, she can get past Sasami. I should stop trying.
Most of you are giving up. I can tell you that much.
Yeah.
We're bad at this.
How about
Kamari just like so trusting and like putting complete faith in Ricky? It's good.
Yeah, honestly, it was something that like I've always wanted to see when somebody, you know, has to ask for help in fiction and it's something kind of unbelievable and she's just like, you're not gonna lie to me about this, so sure. And then she comes over and she asks, you know, a question only Sasami could answer, and that's that.
Yep.
I mean, at least she tried to make sure, you know.
Yeah, it's like that. Kamari is smarter than we think.
Yeah, I mean, well, I said this in the last podcast, but she is a lot smarter than people give her credit for.
How about the other characters? You mentioned Mio briefly. Haruka is also. Oh wow!
Oh yeah.
Probably one of my favorite scenes in this route.
Oh yes,
that's a very
Haruka
funny
in Canada.
Fucking love that apple pie, dude. Maybe I should say from Sofuracha and Senpai.
I don't know how they actually made up with each other, but just seeing them act like genuine siblings is enough to warm up my heart.
Yeah. Easiest choice in the game.
I'm beginning to think that her sister is actually a worse influence on her now than when they were mortal enemies.
It's funny how no matter who you choose in that choice, you just end up pretty much doing the same thing.
Yes, and mm-hmm. also the moment you make a choice, you still complain why are only the most useless people left.
It was Kanata and Haruka.
Well,
and then
he didn't think about Kanata. He just asked Haruka, and Haruka was like, "Yeah, sure, I'll take care of it. Okay, sister, you do this." she just dumped the problem on her.
best skill.
Which is kind of interesting, considering that out of the cast, I do think that Haruka was like one of the smoothest at getting Ricky romance going.
Actually. Okay, how about Kud? I guess she was kind of the same.
Like,
don't forget that scene with Muscly Kud. That Ricky
imagined. Oh yeah, with Kud tries to drink muscle exerciser.
this route definitely carries the Kudex Master ship places.
Well, I definitely ship that.
Who doesn't ship that?
Now, actually, I've talked with Helios about this. How Kud is like the only heroine that has some manner of compatibility with Masato. And I thought this might be related to the troubles that Kud has, that she's worried about her body. Therefore, she might be improve something. And Masato is this guy who's constantly trying to improve his body.
Also, they do kind of have like similar backstories, don't they? Like, they both had... Yeah. They felt isolated and ended up trying to embrace the thing that they were made fun of for in order to try and, you know, find a niche where they were liked.
Very true. Good observation.
And I guess that's the rest of the characters. I mean, Kyosuke disappears until the very end of the route, so I guess we can get...
You already talked about Kengo.
Yeah, we already talked about Kengo. He's Neo Kengo.
Yeah, but what about his relationship with Sasami and how?
Oh, right,
that?
Actually, that was a thing. I mean, that was actually a big part of the route proper. You know, trying to get her to talk with Kengo, and then eventually find out that Kengo is not the one who got her jacket, and that was.
Yeah, I don't really like that scene, to be honest. Like, I feel like it's one of the things, sort of like with Saya turning out to be like Ricky's childhood friend, where it's like, okay, it feels like it's forcing things a little bit too much. I honestly would have preferred if like it was Kengo who got her jacket, and Sasami just realizes over the course of the story that, hey, even though this had like this big spark moment, it's not going to work out, and Ricky also has the traits that she admires Kengo for.
Right.
Yeah.
They didn't have to rewrite their pasts in order to make this work.
Exactly.
Mm. I mean, say what you will about their, you know, Sasami and Kengo's relationship, but it's pretty much really just a high school crush. I watched an anime recently where they were talking about high school crushes, and then you end up choosing someone just because you need to have someone you quote-unquote like, so that you can, whenever you discuss with your friends about, oh, who do you like, and then you say this person. And that, for Sasami, that was Kengo, but at least there was some, you know, deeper meaning to it, because...
Well, at the end of the route, Kengo, eh? Sasami also wonders maybe what she felt... for Kengo was not love after all, and I think this may be something more like not the kind of love that you have for a person next to you, but more like the way you love a star singer or an actor, like someone who's totally awesome but also absolutely unreachable.
I believe you're looking for the word admiration.
Mm. Yeah, it's admiration, not love. And I think part of maturing and part of growing is knowing when someone you like isn't someone who would actually be compatible with you. She's just,
well, on the other hand,
you know, look up to.
She always self-destructs immediately whenever Kengo is around.
Well, I think that's her pride talking again, you know. She always
but
wants to be the best.
Self-destructs are amazing, so, you know.
I really, this route definitely brings out the cuter qualities of Sasami. It makes me appreciate her more.
She's very tsundere. I mean,
I feel like she's maybe a little bit too tsundere. Like, I feel like if there's any chemistry that Riki and Sasami really could have had, it ends up just kind of dissolving into this generic tsundere relationship, I kind of feel.
Well,
I guess. I mean,
is there really any soon in there?
Yeah.
I mean,
like,
she's tsundere for Rin, but with Riki, it's like confusedere.
Fine, I guess. I just feel like sort of all of like the shippy quote unquote moments between them feel to me like they are basically like Riki says something dumb, Sasami pinches his cheeks.
I guess it's not super tsundere where it's like, well, you pretend to hate the character, but
just describe her relationship with Rin.
It's not like she's like beating him up or anything.
Yeah, she's not beating him up or anything, but she definitely, you know, doesn't play well with his jokes. Like comparing it to other characters, like if you do that sort of mon petit thing to them, they'd either play along or say something like Giga Boboe or something. Anyway, this is just, she's more tsun than the others, okay. But
Ricky's too common for her.
Well, it doesn't. One thing I learned about this route is it doesn't even have to be Riki falling in love with Sasami. You can get the good ending even if you actually don't pursue a relationship with her.
Yes, but either way, she does fall in love with him. Right?
True. I mean, in that situation and with the kind of person Riki is, I'd say who wouldn't, you know?
I mean, this is a romance visual novel, so I guess it had to happen.
True. But I don't know. Do you guys think it feels forced or anything?
I feel like it's kind of indicative that like they had to just create a bizarre set of rules to force it so that Sasami can only interact with Riki in order to make this route happen.
Well, sure, that's the setting, but I still feel like the chemistry that forms is like natural.
Hmm. Yeah,
right.
That's
because Sasami has a very special role for Riki in this specific route, and we could argue over
cooking for him.
What's more important in this route? Is it Sasami's troubles or is it Riki's troubles? So if you focus more on what Riki is saying and thinking in this route, more so than what Sasami's troubles are, then you will notice that all this time Riki is worrying about his role. He is now the new leader, or he's supposed to become the new leader. And all the time he's telling himself, all right, I'm the leader now. I have to be responsible. Yeah. I have to get things done. I have to do things on my own. I have to be reliable.
I have to say mission start.
Yeah. I can't
he does say
make
that.
Mistakes.
I love that.
Right? And he's totally putting a lot of pressure on himself, and needlessly, I would say, because this situation isn't all that new. He's done this with other girls, and he's mastered way more difficulties on his way here. Like, he's definitely capable of getting this problem solved as well, but he's putting an extra amount of pressure on himself just because he's the leader now. And Sasami's there, and they take turns getting depressed and then cheering each other up. Like, Sasami goes,
that definitely does that. Yeah.
Like, Sasami goes, oh god damn it, I don't want to keep turning into a cat, what the hell, and Riki tries to cheer her up, and then Riki's like, oh no, I messed up, I was supposed to do this better, and Sasami goes and says, no, you're doing fine, it's
fine.
Okay, and I trust you.
Mm.
Aww.
This is
Sasami. Those were the cuter moments of the route, I have to admit.
Yeah. This is Sasami's role to support him and to tell him he's doing okay. And then also remind him, hey, you're playing baseball, right? And baseball and softball are both team sports. And
team
you're
sports.
You're supposed to be in a team. You're not supposed to be that one player who carries the whole game by himself. That's not
right.
How any of these games work. You have teammates and they trust you, therefore you're good. And you could also say that Sasami's declaration at the end. In the epilogue, Sasami joins the Little Busters, and right away she declares, well, it's not going to be a problem. Me and Riki are going to be the ultimate battery. So she's not only going to join his team, she also declares she is going to be his supporter. Even after her troubles are over,
she'd still support him.
She's still there and she will help him out.
Sasami joining the team is kind of like this, going to be the surrogate for Kyosuke when he leaves.
Oh, I didn't even think of that.
Ouch. Too soon. In a way, she becomes a rival for Rin once again, but for a different way.
Yeah. You know what's scary? Kyosuke knew it was gonna happen. Maybe
damn it.
He assumed it could have happened, because in Rin 2, when Rin is going to the sister school, they sometimes play with Sasami.
There's a scene where like we see a little bit of one of their baseball practices and Sasami is filling in for Rin.
And she helped Riki's team to score once against Kyosuke's team.
She did, didn't she?
Although, to be fair, you don't need to be a magical cat controlling master of the world to see that Sasami wants to be friends with these people.
True. Going back into what you said about Riki trying too hard to be, well, to get things done, I think that also plays into the things that happen. A lot of people say that the whole scenes with Kengo dragged on a bit, and I think that was also because Riki was kind of forcing things in that sense. I mean, he was not seeing the forest for the trees, if we put it that way, because he was too focused on trying to, you know, fix someone's regrets or fix Sasami's regrets, and her regrets are not being able to talk to Kengo instead of trying to figure out what exactly is happening. There were a lot of hints, especially at the beginning, that he might have figured out earlier if he wasn't so pressured by that. And
he misses the main root story and tries to go off after a plot thread that isn't really there.
Yeah. But eventually he gets it, thanks to all the dreams. I think now we can talk about like how the whole dream world works. So it is revealed that it was Kuro who was dreaming this world and brought in Riki and Sasami and whoever else.
Sure.
But yeah. But like, it's pretty interesting how Riki figures this out and how he interacts with other characters outside of this world, the Kyosuke especially, somehow gets a connection with this world.
Kyosuke is a wizard.
I think that's the best way to describe it. There's some very weird things that happen near the end of the route where after you figure out it's
Kengo gets consumed by the vortex.
Honestly,
yeah, Kengo gets consumed.
I absolutely love just the general aesthetic of the world as it's breaking down. The mist everywhere, the render distance, it's just so cool.
There's a lot of cool effects in this route, actually.
I think it's when this world collapses that it also becomes more connected to the real world. And I think that's also how Kyosuke manages to somehow communicate with Riki near the end. Like, he's very invisible in the first few days, but once you see the dream world collapsing, that's when he starts to give Ricky a hand somehow. And not just Kyosuke, right, Aspie?
Yeah, that was also a very interesting moment where Kurugai's presence seems to be hinted. Wasn't it like, yeah, he was hearing the noise of the piano?
Yeah, it's in the non-romantic ending.
Right, speaking of which, I believe Aspie was the one to talk about it in the forum. And he worded it like, possibly Kruger has deliberately made something happen to help Riki out. But I think there's another explanation. Have any of you read through Takafumi's blog post about explaining Kurugaya?
Not quite yet, but enlighten us.
I really want you guys to just read it instead of spoiling
I'm
everything.
I'm sorry, I really
but...
plan to. It's just I haven't gotten around to rereading her route yet.
Basically, what he says is that Kurugaya has her own little world where that is still around, and that is the world that Riki entered and used as a kind of tunnel, but it's always been there, like the refrain world and everything around it collapsed, but Kurugaya's own little world is still there because it still hasn't fulfilled its purpose.
And that'd be what we see in, like, the very end of the normal ending for Kurugaya, where she's sitting in the sunlight waiting.
Right, that one. It's actually its own world.
That's so sad. What the fuck?
That's really interesting.
Okay. Yeah, that is interesting. How he can leap between dream worlds. So.
Yeah.
What about the bad ending?
The bad ending is weird.
The bad ending is just...
Nobody likes that bad ending.
Like,
yeah, it's just Sasami saying, goodbye, Ricky. I'm going to be here. And then nobody remembers.
Yeah, and like, on one hand, I am always interested in stuff that's like, oh, this person's been retconned out of existence. There's faint memories. That's weird. But on the other hand, like, I like how the dream worlds can't really affect reality except through the emotions that they start, and letting them just kind of cut somebody out of time is just kind of like, eh.
Yeah, the system isn't really all-encompassing, because as we talked about in Sire Root, spoilers for that, there's also, like, the time travel.
Well.
Yeah.
Not quite. But...
It is! She travels back in time after she leaves the world.
I mean, they did have to make some kind of bad ending, and I guess this is what the author settled for. Like, I guess he also had to make sure there is some kind of real threat there, a reason to keep fighting.
Right, right. Like, if you get the bad end, not to just give up, you know?
Yeah, but... making Sasami disappear for good is it's overdoing things.
Yeah, I feel like
it didn't
honestly
have to be that bad.
With the way that dream worlds, you know, these worlds are powered by regrets and wishes and such, I honestly feel like it's enough of a threat, enough stakes just to say that if you fail, Kuro's going to die unfulfilled.
Yeah. But whatever. Don't think about it too much. You'll just give yourself a headache.
Yeah. I think that's one thing we learned from Sire, it's way too hard to question this whole dream world shenanigans.
It's kind of a pointless endeavor in the end.
Yeah. In a way, like Ricky figures out very early on that this whole dream world thing defies all logical notion of anything.
It is a mystery.
And that is how he knows he's in the dream world.
Yes. Well,
so did
it sucks that anyway. The logic doesn't apply the whole route.
So did this route make anyone else like kind of want to see a sequel where Ricky's just using the dream worlds to go around granting people's final wishes?
What the
no.
That would be too much Bates. Like Ricky's already done his job.
I mean, can't it only happen to people who are... I can imagine Komari doing that, but not Ricky.
Hmm. Right. Magical girl Komari.
Magical girl Komari.
Magical girl Komari entering the dreams of the people.
That's amazing! I would watch that.
Well, I think we got Aspie hook.
You've sold me.
Time for commissions.
So clearly that's Komari after.
Oh no. Okay. Time to get into the best part of the route, yeah?
Okay.
Oh no.
Well, oh no. I think this is kind of, well, roommate's turn to gush about the ending. Oh. Shivers down my spine.
Yeah.
Okay. Fucking hell, dude. Just fucking stab me, man.
That's... I was blinking back tears during refrain when the boys were saying their goodbye and Komari vanished and such, but this fruit just had me sobbing with Kuro and him taking all of that time trying to find Sasami and them playing together as he slowly died. Ah. And it's just, I have a cat. Ooh. And I just had to go and hug her for a while.
Come so fast. Ain't no time to get prepared for it.
Yeah.
Just fucking comes in and it's all like, hey, do you like your fucking hat? I'm gonna stab it.
It also happens very suddenly. It's like, you know, pulling
That's
the rug
what
down
I was
your
saying.
Throat. Yeah, they introduce Kuro as, you know, just the reason why Sasami hates cats, mm-hmm. You know. We don't really think much of it when she tells that whole story about, oh, she lost her cat, that's so sad. And then he comes back and then she plays with him just one last time.
And the music choice is just perfect.
The voice acting. Yeah, song for friends.
Like,
that was the moment.
Yeah, like, I feel like this, the drama of this route is going to be very specific to each person. I feel like this is a route which will hit certain people who have experienced the loss of a pet a lot harder than people who haven't. There's no psychological aspect to this drama. It's very purely emotion based and just it's very pure, I suppose you could say.
Yeah,
I like to think from a rational perspective that this drama was very, how you say, I won't say forced, but it's very low-hanging fruit. Like, this is the kind of thing that you could pretty much put it into any story and it would have that appeal, but
sure.
I don't care because it's fucking good.
Yeah. Dude, Little Buster's is cat story, so it makes perfect sense here.
Yeah, well, sure.
And it has Sasami one-upping Rin on the whole dying cat playing with scene.
Oh no, yeah. You're right.
Shoutouts to Miles.
Mm-hmm. Shoutouts to Miles.
Although
best scene
it does
Rin.
Have like the one extra element to it, which is how it ties together with Ricky's own feelings, like how he feels about his parents and such, which I do think is an interesting twist.
Mesh.
I'm not going to reference Takia.
Anyway, it is very wonderfully executed. That's all I
painfully.
Can. Painfully executed.
Yeah.
It's a good route, guys.
Just, this is all he wanted, man. This is all the cat wanted, dude.
He just wanted to
go
gooda gooda
gooda on his belly.
I guess part of the execution is like it's easy enough to write a story about the dying cat and playing with them one last time, but more than once, Sasami, you know, she hates herself because she feels that, oh, this cat probably resents me, and that's why I don't like cats, because they run away and they won't hate me if I leave them alone.
A dog comes when you call its name.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
dog
so
comes
does
when
an
you
apron.
Call its name.
Well, at least an apron doesn't run away in the first place.
Good. Well, that is how you start the whole conversation anyway, because of the cat apron, which is apparently Rin's.
That makes sense. Wait, Rin can't cook.
Good point. Why does she?
Because she saw it and she thought that it was cute.
It has a cat on it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Anyway, but yeah,
that
I think
one
that's
squared away.
All part. We finished the biggest mystery, guys. Good job. I think the whole message of this whole ending scene is that because it is better to have had something. I mean, at the very end of your life, it's you don't resent that which you had. You don't wish that somebody suddenly wish that you never had that feeling because you enjoyed it, you know? Mm-hmm. You don't regret it and you don't resent it. Like, maybe some people would, but the normal thing is to look back on it and want to go and have that feeling again, you know?
One thing I want to bring up that I kind of mentioned the forum, but I don't know if anyone responded to. There was a lot of talk about how, you know, this route was kind of like a contrivance to push Sasami and Riki together. But then I posit the idea that what if this is what Kuro wanted?
Hmm.
What if Kuro was trying to ship Riki and Sasami?
It begs the last unanswered mystery of the whole route. Why Riki? Why could only Riki interact with Sasami?
Exactly.
Why didn't he choose Komari? She was there all the time, and she's perfect.
Wasn't it because like Riki and Kuro's feelings overlapped?
Yes, because it's a problem related to losing your parents.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's it.
Oh.
I kind of like the idea that Kuro just ships these two.
But then I have to ship those two too, or else risk disappointing a dying cat.
Oh no.
Well, that's dark.
Well, we do see Riki interacting with Kuro, and he's very... He does, attune to Riki at the beginning, and not very much to Rin. We know Komari and Sasami were already taking care of him at that time, so I think it's pretty much... it's pretty much Kuro sensing that Riki is a nice guy, and you know, maybe he's the kind of guy who could have been what I wasn't for my mom.
I had actually figured that it's maybe even a little bit deeper than that, where like maybe Kuro wasn't even necessarily trying to do that, but rather that just happened to be like the result of Kuro's body ended up stuck in Sasami, and his feelings kind of ended up wrapping around Riki. And so things only really worked out properly when the two were together.
There's just way too much we can read into here. Again.
Oh my God, your Kanon. Work all along.
Did you just make that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Kuro was the orchestrator of the world all along.
As soon as somebody said it was the cat was the culprit. Quickly cooked that.
Well, we can add that to the fan art segment, which I think is a good segue.
All right.
For fan art this week, we have this piece by Kanon. We have this art of Rin and Sasami by Artifedex. And we also have this piece by Shizuru-chan. So thank you once again to everyone who submitted fan art.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Kanon, for making that on the spot just now.
Oh, damn it. All right. So for MVP,
back to you.
I'm going to go ahead and announce that it is...
Yeah, what have you done for this? I've given you control over this, Pepe. What have you decided?
I think it's pretty much decided after discussing with the rest of the busters, but I think the forum has decided that Aspi is the MVP of Sasami Root. Pachi, 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 pachi,
oh my
pachi.
God.
Pachi,
can't just make me the MVP.
I don't know, man. I think everyone agrees that you had the best contributions in the topic, and you're one of the people who actually had discussion you know, continue instead of just posting something and then leaving it be.
Yeah, give up and accept your prize.
God damn. Well, if everyone says I should win, then I guess I'll accept.
I mean, yeah.
Thank you.
So yeah, thank you, Aspie, and thank you to everyone else who gave their good thoughts on the forum. Other than Aspie, there was adeptArcanist and who else? Grooven as well. Bread had a really good good writing about how this route is very tight, and I think that's something that we all agree on. So yeah, I guess that ends our podcast.
Righto. I guess I'll take it from here. Okay. We have one more podcast left to record, and that's the Kanon to Root podcast. We're still figuring out the scheduling for this. We're hoping to record it next weekend, but it might be the weekend after. With that said, thank you for joining us for this podcast, everybody. I apologize for my bad mic quality. My back is broken, so I couldn't sit down in my chair for a long time, so I've been carrying around the mic with me. Hopefully it's not too bad and we can salvage it. Anyway, thanks for joining, everybody, and we'll see you next one.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Yeah.
この場所で見送る君と約束明日は手をつなごう虹の